Mashi, Mashi, I'm not gonna lie. I switched this over before the introduction happened because I wanted people to see your little dance. It was really good. usually Mashi knows when we're about to go live because I switch over and here, and I'm like, "Hey, everybody, welcome to today's episode of Magic FM. I'm Gary Sport 20 Rose today." But I wanted people to see that you were jamming.
There's good. A little bit of, I can't hear the music either. That's the thing.
Yeah, that's my favorite part about it is I hear like the song, so I'm like, this is cool, but you're just rocking out to it. How are you doing, Mosh? It's good to see you.
I'm doing wonderful, Gabby. How are you doing?
Awesome. I'm excited for episode 47 of Magic FM today. 47. Dude. We're getting there.
I know. Yeah. 52 is the 1 year. We got to do something. What do we do?
We're going to do something for 1 year for sure.
Yeah, we totally have to. We totally
we
have
will,
to.
We'll think about what sounds fun for that, but we'll definitely do something because I think just having done an entire year of podcasting, plus I believe we only have missed one episode in the entire year. Ironically, yep. It was one time that we were both at the same site, but we were just there work for work, and it was pretty busy.
It was not possible. It was one of the last events before COVID too.
Yeah, that was the last trip I took before quarantine started. It was
really we got super lucky. Elaine's cousin, her husband's boss let us use their cabin in Tahoe. So all four of us went up there and they have a dog. So we brought the dogs. And like literally we got back on Sunday. On Monday, Elaine started a new job, went to the office. They sent everyone home and quarantine started on Tuesday.
I remember. And she just had to do the rest of, that's so strange.
It's crazy. So I at the time I was like, oh man, I feel so rushed in Tahoe. We should get you moved up and settled because I was really just working remote here in the Bay Area and living in LA. But you know, I needed to focus on the channel fireball.com. So I moved back up here full time and she came up here. And now I'm just so thankful we took that time.
Yeah. I remember you were trying to talk Luis and I to go to Texas for like, I think there was a Magic Fest in Texas. I think it might have been like a finals or something. And we were like, I don't know. We'll see if it happens. And then just it was not remotely close to being an option by the time that rolled around.
Well, I mean, I don't know if you remember this. I flew out to Magic Fest Detroit. While I was on the plane, because I got internet on the plane, I was in a Slack chat with everyone at CFB events. While I was on the plane, we were discussing things with Wizards, and it literally got canceled while I was in the air.
Oh,
flying to Detroit.
Oh my God, I remember. And you landed and you were like, hey guys, I'm here. I remember when you had hopped on the flight. Because I also had a couple friends who were going, and they're like, I don't know if I should go. Like, it looks like I might get canceled. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, I don't know if I'd risk it. So, yeah.
It was bad. I remember the last thing I said to Kevin is like, dude, I just have this feeling I'm going to get off the plane. It's going to be canceled. I'm going to get the first flight back. It's so, like, immediately when it happened, I got off the plane and texted him. I'm like, dude, I can't believe it. So, okay. Gabby, hard-hitting questions.
Let's hear it.
Before we dive into this episode, what was for dinner tonight?
I'm going to have dinner after this. I had
and
a late
what
lunch.
Is it going to what's
it
going to
be? I don't know. We have some burritos that we had for breakfast that we have left over for dinner. They're from this place that just makes these like really good burritos. So I think I'm just going to heat that up.
Not a calzone. Mm-hmm. Did you have a breakfast burrito for breakfast or a regular burrito for breakfast?
It was a breakfast burrito for breakfast, but we got extras because Luis just like went through the truck or something that tells them. So we just had extra burritos and I had kind of a late lunch. So just probably going to eat the like rest of like the basically the other burrito that was remnant.
What's your meat of choice when you have a burrito?
This is a sad story. I love bacon, but I learned as an adult that bacon does not love me. So I can't have bacon anymore. It's really sad. I truly love bacon.
Wait, you can't have any?
I don't have any bacon at all. It gives me acid reflux, like really, really bad. Yeah. Whoa. So I don't have any bacon anymore. So I go to sausage now or turkey bacon. Turkey bacon's good too.
Yeah. I mean, it's funny you say that because I discovered that I had heartburn. The first time I had heartburn, I remember this so vividly. I was sitting in my father's minivan. He had an Astro minivan. And I'd gotten some sausage McMuffin with eggs. And this was big Mashi. I would eat four of those. And I remember I ate like two of them. And I was like, oh my God, what's that? And for a second, I was like, am I having like a heart attack? Like, what is happening?
Because
it was like so much
pain really,
in my chest.
Because it feels like it's in your chest, not in your stomach. I totally,
And it felt like someone was stabbing me. And I remember I started just kind of like hitting my chest like this because I felt like I had to relieve pressure or something. So yeah, sausage has, I have to be very careful with breakfast sausage. Bacon, I'll eat till the cows come home. But
I too can't have sausage egg McMuffins from McDonald's without feeling bad. But the breakfast sausage from these burritos like are totally fine for me. So it's sad. I just have to kind of play it safe, you know. It's unfortunate.
One day in the after times when we're through this, there is a place in Burbank, California. Not that, I mean, maybe if there's a GP or something, we'll both be in LA, or all four of us will be in LA together. It has the best, I'm not joking, no joke. It's called Corner Cottage, the best breakfast burritos on the planet.
Oh, that sounds so good. I love breakfast burritos. I'm a huge fan.
I mean, this place is like literally, they don't take credit. It's cash only. You can't order ahead. If you don't get there before like 10 a.m.
They sell out?
The line, they don't sell out. The line is it's like an hour wait just to get there. It's ridiculous. It's insane.
So, I actually love places like that. I don't know. There's something about like that's very appealing to me about those. That's super cool.
Yeah. Well, yeah. One day.
Before we get into the episode today, obviously we had to talk about food. I want to do a quick shout out for the sponsor of the podcast, channelfireball.com. Zendikar Rising is out now, baby. Woo!
Yeah. New type 2. That's all we care about.
Oh my god, standard, new type 2.
New type.
Go home. Well, if you play type 2 or standard like a normal person, or anything else pretty much, Zendikar Rising is out and there's a lot of really cool, exciting new mechanics for it. And Channel Fireball is there if you want to buy anything like that. So if you want to buy booster boxes, there's a new set boosters, which I actually have one booster that I want to open on, like that I want to open on Twitter. That is the basically, it's like supposed to be like a more exciting booster to open. We've talked about them on Magic of Fun before.
Yeah, the set boosters, sure.
Yeah, so it's supposed to like tell a story from start to finish and stuff. But they're really cool. Like if you just want to open, like buy boxes to just for the sake of buying boxes, those are pretty neat. Slash, all the new cards are out for the set. So if you play anything like Cube or Commander, etc., it's a really good time to pick up some of those cards. If you are buying some of those cards, you could use the code MAGICFM.
Do it. Yeah. Support the podcast. Boy, I got to tell you, these scrybabies, all I ever hear from Dennis, from Riley, and all the scrybabies on Twitter is use that smart code, use that smart code. And in all fairness, go ahead and use that smart code because the more I push that on this podcast, the more I can take credit for all the uses of this.
Oh, there you go. We're going to start taking credit. That's going to make the scrybabies happy.
I guarantee it because Dennis will be like, oh, hey, Mosh, look, another U-Box we buy with Smar. And I'm like, oh, yeah, I mentioned on Magic FM this week. So that's probably us.
You're like, no big deal. It was probably our podcast. Thank you very much.
Yeah, yeah. No, you're welcome.
All jokes aside, like the affiliate codes that you hear us, you know, talk about here on Magic FM or Smar or any of your other content producers from Channel Fireball, they are a really awesome way to support their streamers because it goes directly to them. So whether it be Magic FM, Smar, or anything else, if you're shopping on channelfireball.com, great thing to just always use a code. It's just smart to use a code, anyone's code, really.
I mean, it costs you nothing and it helps support all the content producers, and so I just think it's a wonderful thing to do. Just pick one and go for it, or if you want to change it up, whatever you do. But I totally agree with you, Gabby. Every time you're on, you know, signing up for CFP Pro or buying Channel Fireball, use a code. It doesn't hurt anything. It helps a lot. So
it is awesome. Then I was also just going to do a tiny little shout out because there is a CFP Pro showdown going on this weekend. And I am very excited for it because one, I'm going to play in it. I don't have a deck yet. I'm going to play in it. But second, we did something so cool that I just wanted to shout out. We have bounties in the event, and usually bounties are like you play against that player, you get like an extra prize or something. So our bounties for this event are Alias V, Jana Mari, Eshlizel, Nassif, and Riley Knight, many of who have been guests here on Magic FM. And they all have a reason for why they're wanted on their wanted poster. So like Riley is wanted for eating pizza backwards, and Nassif is wanted for unauthorized headgear, and...
It's all fun stuff. I mean, these posters, I mean, shout out to Jeffrey Palmer, you know, at Living Cards MTG. He made these posters and they are awesome. I think they're really cool. Got that Western outlaw.
Yeah, it's like it just looks like an old school wanted poster with everybody has reasons for why they're wanted. Like Jana's wanted for reckless obliteration. We told the Jana story about Phyrexian Obliterator here on the podcast as well. It's really funny. But yeah, that's going on this weekend. So if you haven't signed up, and you're hearing this because you'll be hearing it maybe tomorrow on Friday, there's still time to sign up for the CFP Pro Showdown going down this Saturday. End boss is Reed Duke.
That's a tricky one, man. I would not want to fight Reed Duke either in Magic or otherwise.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm in
any setting.
Yeah. Just in general, I'm excited. I think the showdowns, just a little inside baseball here. We did Magic Fest online so many times. There's more staff and kind of influencer and superstar CFB employees and contractor participation in the showdowns than anything else. Like people, people that work with us, they just love playing in that event. It's just a lot of fun.
They're really fun events. And the other thing about them is they are single elimination, if you didn't know that. So you can, like, what I'm going to do is I'm going to play, like, I think blue, black, rogues. And if I do great, great. And if I lose, that's fine. You know, I was out round one and then I get to go have brunch. So
yeah,
really fun, lighthearted tournament. If you have never played in one of them and you do have CFP Pro, super recommend. If you don't, you can sign up for CFP Pro and then you can play in those for free. So just wanted to shout that out before we get further into the podcast. Well, there's a lot of stuff that happened this week, Mashi.
Yeah, well, Zendikar Rising is, you know, it's out. It's ostensibly live on Magic Arena. And so I guess it's definitely live on Magic Arena. Whether Magic Arena is live is a different question. So I already shared my story here where I got super excited. I've been super busy at the office because I've been going into the warehouse, you know, and I said, you know what? Taking a 20-minute break, I'm going to draft my first Zendikar Rising draft. And you know, I do what I always do. This is I'm gonna shamelessly plug, but this is actually just totally honestly what I do. I go to Frank Karsten's kind of pick order article, and I'd read it the other day, and I actually have it up, and I kind of flip through it, take a look at like what he does in pick order, and some of the stuff I agree with, some of the stuff I don't, but I just have it on the screen so I can see it. And I've been looking at Luis's set reviews, and all that helps. I like to use that. I don't think that's like set in stone, but it's a great starting point, you know, to look at that stuff, familiarize yourself, and then take a look. So I got everything ready to go. I got the pick orders from Karsten up. I boot up Arena, have a little problem, get in, great, I'm sold. 1500 gems, sign me up, let's go. And everything's ready. I hit ready, let's go. And just as the pack is about to open, right, like I'm gonna see my 15, black screen.
Yeah.
And that's
God, no.
And I was done. I tried to get back in. I was like, nope, couldn't do it. And about an hour later, I'm like, okay, let me see if they just refunded the gems or what happened. And sure enough, I've got the world's worst draft deck right now.
Yeah, of course it's like how nice that I have. Wow, it's the rainbow. I can paint with all the colors of the wind. It's just every
it's
color.
It's true. It really, really is. So I immediately was like, what the heck is going on? And then I looked at Twitter and I was like, okay, this is not just a Mashi thing. You. This is happening everywhere.
Yeah, so this is something I wanted to touch on because I heard from a lot of people who were very frustrated about this. And I'm not sure why, but it feels like with every release, it's less, mm-hmm. like MTGA is less and less stable. And I don't know if there's, so many people who want to play Arena on the day it comes out, or their servers are just really not capable of handling it. But I saw so many people who were like, I haven't played Magic in 3 months. And I was like, really looking forward to playing this draft. And I just, you know what? I'm not even going to bother. And it just feels like such a bad user experience and missed opportunity. It makes me really sad for Magic that's the experience that so many people out there are having.
It makes me really sad. I mean, I was very frustrated. I, as I said before we went live, I was like, I got really angry. And then, you know, when you get that angry and then you kind of step outside yourself and you're like, whoa, dude, you are way too angry for like, you know, obviously you're busy at work. You're stressed out. That's the frustration. You should not be this angry.
Yeah. You're like, you need to like, just kind of like just wind like, back for a second. The other thing that was super awkward that was happening to people is that you could log into Arena and get, because you know rotation's happening, so you would get the renewal, which on Magic Arena is when you get a bunch of stuff basically to make up for the fact that most of your stuff is not legal anymore. So you get wild cards and some other random miscellaneous like rares and uncommons and stuff. You could sign on to Magic Arena before Zendikar Rising was live, so you would not get any of the new cards as your reward. So you would basically get all stuff that was about to rotate. Which is really bad.
Oh my God.
Yeah. So that's I don't know if they fixed that, but that was just like, can you imagine? Like, here's your reward. It's all cards that are rotating. Good luck.
Yeah. Here's a bunch of Ravnica stuff. Great.
Like, yeah. Just ugh. Like, oh.
I am sad that this happened. And what really frustrates me about it is we used to have not on the scale of Arena on release day, but just as an example, you know, when we started implementing software, the software we were using at events for like registering your deck list or signing up for events online, like on the Thursday, we had to throttle way up our server usage, like pay like quintuple what we had just when we weren't using it for a live event. Cause you know, that's your high traffic time is all right. I'm saying. Right? You know, like, and maybe, hey, it's COVID and the audience was just so huge because of shelter in place, and so huge because I know a lot of us were ready for this rotation and wanted to get in that just water like, right
out
now.
Out with more of the spark, in with Rising, Zendikar Rising.
Yeah. And so, you know, all of that may have contributed to it, but it's really frustrating because it's like, you couldn't tell this spike was, you knew this spike was coming. If this was just a server, you knew.
Yeah.
Know? So that part's a little bit.
Yeah. That part was disappointing. I felt bad for players who had a really frustrating experience with that. I honestly felt bad for Wizards because like this just cost them so much money, and I'm sure the people who were working on it were working tirelessly to fix it and they weren't able to. Which is also like, man, God, I like what a disappointing day when it's release day and everyone's excited to play with your new cards and all that people get is just like the loading error. So
yeah.
That was the bad part.
It's just what you said is a tough thing. You get all these like really motivated people like, yeah, I'm ready to get in there, and you just kind of put those flames like, right out. That sucks.
Yeah. But yeah. Zendikar Rising is out. And we did want to talk a little bit about what that was like. And specifically one thing that you and I were talking about right before the podcast, which is the lands, these like modal lands.
I love them.
Yeah, so I want to hear the Mashi like constructed Monday meta take. Like, what do you think of the lands?
I think the lands are amazing, and one of the things I think you immediately I will ask Martin more about this on Monday is one of the biggest issues we have in Magic, right, is mana screw and mana flood, and this won't solve mana screw necessarily. Although if it's in addition to basics, maybe it does, but I think it does help with mana flood. The more of these you have, I feel like you have an alternate use for these lands. And I just got to play with them a bit more. I'm just so curious to see how this affects things, because you know, one school of thought says you have the same amount of lands in your deck and these are just extra, and so you never have to worry about mana screw because now you're playing with like, you know, 30 lands or something. On the other hand, you could cut way down and all of your, like, you know what's crazy, Gabby? I saw a Belcher deck and the only lands it had were these
modal
lands.
Oh, really?
Yeah, like
that's
crazy, right?
So yeah, that's kind of sweet.
You're playing no lands. You're just playing these modal, because when they flip the library, right, the top is the spell. They don't count as lands. So
right, the face card is usually the spell.
Right, and you cannot choose, right, because I think there's like a triangle.
The triangle that's facing up, like the triangle like this, is the front of the card, which is what the card is in like other places. I know because I had to ask Eric Levine, because my preview card was the modal green land that that's either a like a forest or, well, not forest, like taps for green, or a 1/1 that taps for green, and I was like, Eric, can this get Thoughtseize from my hand? And he explained it to me, and I was like, okay, perfect, yes. So those definitely, like, the face front triangle, that's the face of the card. And so if Thoughtseize could Thoughtseize it away, like, yes, that counts as a front.
Yeah, I learned it because we were talking about that Lurgoyf Vampire on the Monday meta. Mm-hmm. And I was like, oh my gosh, modal lands are going to buff this by two. Or do they buff it by two? Because it's a land and a spell. Oh my God, that's so amazing. And literally... on the card itself, it's like, only count the face part of the spells in the graveyard. And people in the chat were like, dude, it says it on the card. And I'm like, oh God, it literally says it on the card.
That's really funny. Because also Twitch chat loves pointing stuff like that out. Like, God forbid you said that something costs one more than it did. Like, they're going to point it out.
It's always funny because, you know, I feel pretty good because obviously – this is a podcast. We don't do this one live, but Monday Meta we do live. And one of the things I like about that is I can kind of say or do whatever I want, and I got an eye on chat, and I know I'm going to get corrected if I'm totally wrong about something. Like, so, and you know, and then from the chat point of view, they're like, "Oh, Mashi's got it wrong." But from the podcast point of view, I'm like, "Actually, blah 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 blah."
That's really funny. Yeah, playing with those lands has been really cool. Because it also has made drafting a little different. You know how when you draft like cube, I know you and I talk about cube all the time. Oh my God. But you know when you're drafting cube, how you have to like place importance to taking lands? Because experience from like the 2 days that I've drafted it so far is that usually when you're playing a normal limited set, you get enough playables, like assuming that you didn't like make a crazy pivot halfway through because you got like a great card or something, but you usually get enough playables and then maybe like a couple of cards that you got for your sideboard that were interesting, and then maybe like a dual end or two. But there are enough cool flip lands that have utility or synergy in your deck that you actually have to put a lot more work into making sure that you have enough playables, because I've ended up in these decks that had a lot of the cool flip lands and not enough playables. And I'm like, oh my God, what am I going to do? I guess I'm running this like 3-mana 2/3 no other text because I actually didn't have enough playables for this draft.
Did you get a lot? So, because my initial thought, I actually thought about this because I thought I was going to be drafting today. My initial thought was to try to scoop up as many of the modal lands, particularly if they were in two colors, as possible, because I didn't think I was going to see very many of them in the draft. I thought they'd be very high picks because they're so useful that I'd be like, okay, well, here's a red modal land. Unless I see a bomb, you know, in a pack, then, you know, but that was kind of my initial thought. I was like, when in doubt, I'm just going to take a bunch of these modal lands because they're just like bonus spells in my deck.
Yeah. So I think, when I was talking to my stream about this, there were a couple of like different opinions, and I thought it was really interesting. Some people thought that the cards are overvalued right now because people are seeing that. They're seeing like, whoa, this is basic. This is a free roll, right? This could be a land, or it could be an awesome 5-mana 4/5 or something, like, which is just feels so free to have in your deck. And then some other people were like, these are not being overrated. Like, these are really powerful and you should try to get as many as you can in your deck. So it does feel like, I mean, the true cost is the fact that it comes, Jules, what are you doing? She's going ham. The true cost is that they do come into play tapped. So like if somebody is playing, you know, this is kind of weird, but I drafted a lot of decks that had a lot of those modal lands. And then the best deck that I've had in the format just didn't play a single one of them. It was just straight up blue white, no flip lands. So I'm not saying that that's what you want to do, but there is a cost to kind of like having to play these tap lands because they do slow you down. And as much as it's nice to have this dual spell, some of the spells are not as good. Like I will be happy to be corrected about this, but there's this land that's either censor or enters
an island.
Islander sensor. And so we got into this debate where we were like, they're like, why don't you want to play the sensor land? I chose not to play it in my deck. And I'm like, because this is just, I think, much worse than sensor. I might be wrong. I'm totally willing to entertain that. But sensor, it's great at the beginning of the game. And if you're done with it, you just cycle it away and you're done. When you realize that you have this land and you wanted it in play, it's going to come into play tapped. So you needed to play it last turn. So the cost of holding up your sensor land and then missing your land drop is so much more costly than putting a sensor in your deck. So it also is going to make you have to evaluate cards differently, because the fact that it's a modal land doesn't automatically make it good. And in fact, some of them are really awkward with the fact that they're lands.
Yeah, I buy that. I buy, because, you know, a lot of Amonkhet Remastered was, you know, you'd get your deserts. And sometimes you would get those wonky, like double desert draw or whatever. Mm-hmm. And you start thinking like, if I'm trying to curve out in some way, it's like, wait a minute. Okay. Turn one. Okay. That's fine. I don't have a one drop. But if you're trying to sequence it where you got like, you know, your turn two, turn three, and you're thinking, am I going to draw another land? Is this going to be my two drop? Like it does get really, really wonky trying to play around, you know, coming to play tap lands. And the more you have, the more wonky it can get. Right.
Yeah, absolutely. I definitely had a bunch of games where I was like, you know, land happy over here with like 5 lands that came into play tapped that were extra spells. Meanwhile, my opponent's going like 1, 2, 3, you're dead. And I was like, oh, damn. Like maybe I should have put, you know, better lands in my deck and like creatures that could block. So that is interesting. Like it also makes it so that you have a lot more cards in your deck because you are playing these things that double up as lands or like you have to make decisions with it. And those tend to make for fun limited formats because the fun limited formats are the ones where you constantly have to be evaluating stuff. Like fun limited formats a lot of times have flip cards or have had like fuse cards or like cards that you can flash back and stuff like that. And this is just like a variant of that. That is really cool because it's attached to a land.
Were you able to assemble a party?
So the party mechanic is interesting. It feels like it's actually quite hard to assemble a party. Because almost every color has reasons that you care about having a full party, but not all the colors have party members. Like white only has one wizard. It's like a 3-mana 3/3 that when it ETBs you draw a card. And it's like the only white wizard. Everything else is like a cleric or like a rogue.
Wow. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is, I actually, when we were doing the hot takes for Channel Fireball, there's the Pack Beast. And I was like, this is going to be a must in every draft deck. And I know I'm going to call him out. I think it was Ben from Lords Unlimited who was like, had some tweet that was not very favorable to my hot take on the Pack Beast. It's gone now, though. I think he took it down.
Oh, I was like, Pack Beast is the one that's the counts for every, like, it counts as any kind you need, right? And it's like artifact.
It's a two colorless, 2/1, I think. And then it counts as a member of a party.
I believe it also has like pay 2 colorless to make a mana of a color. I think it like filters right.
Yeah.
Too.
Prismite. Is that Prismite? I think it's Prismite.
Yeah, I think that's Prismite does that too. Yes. Yeah. I'm not 100% sure. But yeah, no, I thought that was cool. Like it has been cool to kind of be like drafting to try to get party members. Mm-hmm. I will say that it has felt very hard to assemble the party, even when I drafted 100% trying to be like full on party mode. And I heard that one of the things that happened with Wizards is that they try to do 5 and have rogues be one of them, or excuse me, druids be one of them. But apparently it was like too hard to keep track of 5 party members. So they were like, nah, okay, just green doesn't get any party members. <Sorry, laughs> Forget those druids, just psh, away with them.
Wow. I will say, I think it's going to be incredibly difficult in this format to have all 4. So what do you think the rule of thumb is? If I'm drafting, I know you've had a few drafts under your belt. If I'm drafting and I've got party spells that count that, should I just maybe -1? I was thinking like -2, like you're averaging have like maybe 2 members of a party in play.
I think the majority of the time when I've had a good party deck, like where I really, really emphasize trying to make sure I got members of all the party and even end up with some of the cards that count for everyone, like the 2/1 beast, that one.
Uh-huh.
I still feel like at best I had like 3 party members. I think I've assembled a full party once. And I will say that there's not that many cards that care about you having a full party, but like for a lot of them you still get a really good benefit. Like if it's scry for number of members in the party, that's great. If it's like it costs less for the number of members in the party, also good.
So I can't wait. I'm part of the reason, like, look, people are frustrated about what happened with Arena today, but part of that's because we're also excited to play Zendikar Rising.
Agreed.
So, you know, Wizards did a great job. I think the set actually looks like a lot of fun, particularly for limited. I think Kicker's a fun limited ability. The modal lands look great. Party does feel like way more of a limited ability than a constructed ability. So there's a lot of ways that when I'm looking at this set, it looks like it was really, really kind of made and honed a bit for limited.
Yeah, I agree with that. I also think that the lands will matter a ton in constructed, but in limited is typically where you're more likely, because in a constructed deck you can construct it so that you have mana sinks into it, like, mm-hmm. or you have ways of like what your end game looks like, or you can build your deck so if it's a control deck you have card draw so you don't flood. So you're less likely to run into those situations in constructed, but it's really cool that this is a thing that's really going to impact limited, because that I think does lead to more fun games. Like I have liked playing it a lot and I'm excited to keep exploring it. You know, like it's not like we talked about Ikoria a little bit. It just didn't really do it for me, but I think the flavor and theming and the stuff that's going on here is like a way more fun.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think it's going to be a way slower format than like M21 and, Amonkhet Remaster and even Ikoria.
Amonkhet Remaster is just too fast, too furious is the thing. that format's like so fast.
It is. I save all my, like anytime I win 7 in a limited format, I'll save the deck just kind of, I can go back and reference
it. So you can go back and see it. Yeah.
Do I have and all this stuff. And I will tell you this, I learned after my third, I didn't have a lot of 7 wins. I'm not great at draft, but the one thing that was consistent that I picked up on very early is, oh my gosh, the most important thing here is curve. Like 2 drops, 3 drops.
Yes. You have to curve out maybe. Sure.
But it was just like super duper, like, you know, turn 4 isn't about a 4-drop. It's about double spelling, you know, so many times. So yeah, that was, but I think Kicker by its very nature, I feel like is a slower, party mechanics mean slow down, have the creatures in play, you know, use the party mechanics. So I think it's going to be a slower format.
Yeah.
I can't wait.
I'm excited. This format has felt like it's done a lot to try to mitigate the flood between the lands, Kicker, and just ways to like rebuy spells and stuff. There's a lot of this set in particular has a lot of like, do X, draw card, like do X mm-hmm. thing, then draw card if you meet certain conditions, which also kind of keeps the games kind of flowing. So pretty excited about Zendikar Rising. I would love to hear. I want to hear what you think. If you do some drafts this weekend, when we come into like kind of like week two of the format and see how where we're at. But it's been pretty fun so far.
Good, good, good. Hopefully, my final thoughts on Arena is I'm gonna go to bed tonight. I'm gonna wake up tomorrow at some point. I'm gonna boot it up and everything's gonna be fine.
I'm sure it's gonna be fine tomorrow. It was just today was a really kind of overloaded bad day, and I had so many people keep asking me like, "Oh, are you off MTGA?" And it's like, no, I literally just can't play on Magic Arena.
So, do you think, Gabby? Serious mm-hmm. question. There's tons of MTGA conspiracies. Do you think those Magic Online developers had anything to do with what happened today in Arena?
Truth is out there, Mashi.
I'm the just truth saying.
Is out there.
How many people went and booted up Modo, maybe for the first time in a long time? I was like, F this, I am downloading Magic Online.
The thing that got you to download Magic Online, but still no. It
almost did. And then I realized the economy is a little bit different. I got to go buy ticks and get packs. And I'm just like,
If you don't have like the ticks or the packs or like whatever, or the play points, it is a hassle. I would not recommend it.
Yeah, I don't even know what a play point is. So
play points are a new thing that is just like if you it's kind of like gold on Arena. That's what play points are. They don't have real value, but you can enter events with them and you can enter any event with them. So if you just have a bunch of play points, you just always use play points to join anything.
Gotcha. Yeah, it's just good. Like the gold.
Yeah, it's just like gold. All right. Well, there was a cool tournament this weekend. And I wanted us to touch on some stuff that happened because I feel like there was a lot of action regarding this tournament. The Mythic Invitational was this weekend. The format was historic and we both spent a good amount of time watching it. And there was a lot of action. What were your general thoughts about the Mythic Invitational, Mashi?
First of all, I want to remind everyone that I, just based on how Luis was talking about the format, on last week's episode, I was like, I feel really good about Luis. I think he's going to top 8 this thing. And I mean, and he did. You know, spoilers, Luis made the top 8.
Hashtag spoiler alert.
Yeah. If you didn't know, now you know. But it's just a funny thing with Luis. Like, just hearing him talk about Magic, hearing him talk about his deck and his choices, there's just a way he, and I'm sure you've heard it too, like you can just kind of feel the confidence. Like he feels really good about this deck, he knows this deck, and you know he's gonna do well. And I definitely felt that way, and I was so happy. I mean, what a treat, by the way. What a treat for all of us who've been following Magic for a very long time, since 2008, whatever, because Luis won. He won his first Pro Tour in 08. Is that his only Pro Tour win? I'm not sure. And then, you know, the next time he came in second to Gabriel Nassif. And what a treat for all of us to see Luis and Gabriel Nassif play not just once, but twice at this Mythic Invitational.
Mm-hmm. It was really sweet. They played again in the top 8. And I completely agree. Luis is very sincere when he talks about deck choices. Like, you know how some people are like, I totally flunked that test and they like aced it. I think Luis is very honest when he tells you like, hey, I think my deck is great. Like the deck is usually pretty good. Hey, I think my deck is awful or I have no idea what to register. It's like, usually that means that like format is complicated and there's no deck that's like better than others. So people are just like, I don't know. It feels kind of like a toss up. Like I can just send whatever and it'll be okay.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it was really cool to watch, especially because during his top 8 run, when he took, I think his third loss, he was so sure he was out. And I was just like, oh, man, like, that stinks. And I was, like, really bummed out about it. And then, like, he still snuck in. So later when we were talking to Pat Cox, a really good friend of his, he's like, yeah, as soon as you complained about being out, I knew you were just going to top 8. I just knew it.
Oh, my God. That is classic Luis. I mean, he wasn't sandbagging because he messaged us too. He messaged me on Slack and he's like, I think I'm dead. And I'm just like, oh my God. And I think I messaged you and I was like, okay, how's he doing? And you're like, do you want to know? Do you want to know?
Yeah.
I'm like, please.
I was like, do you want to know?
I want
to know.
Yeah. Top 8, baby. So it was always thrilling, you know, to see Luis. I will say of all the events, for some reason, and if this is just me, it's just me. That's fine. And maybe this was seeing Gabriel Nassif and Luis play, but Luis played Huey. Something about this event, more than other like MPL and events I've seen online, this one really felt like, holy crap, the greatest players in the world playing right now are playing each other. And I, for some reason, this one, and maybe just roll the dice who got paired against who and yes, I follow Luis, you know, more than anyone else in this, but it felt like there were some just amazing matches here.
I agree. I think, I don't know if it was luck of the draw or like how the pairings landed or the way they featured the feature matches was pretty good, because I do think they did a really good job with that. But I completely agree that like most of the Mythic Invitational felt like day 2/3 of the former Pro Tour, where the beginning of the Pro Tour was like you could kind of see anything. It was like the Wild West. And then day 2 is when you started seeing like all the familiar faces and all the really good players playing against each other. And obviously the top 8 usually is like all names you recognize. This felt like it was that all the way through. And that was cool. Yeah. I really enjoyed, like, I thought spectating the Invitational was cool. There were a lot of problems with the Invitational, which is one of the things we're going to touch on. But I think, like, as a concept and the way it played out, that part was really cool.
Well, Gabby, obviously you like this tournament. You were a beneficiary of some outside assistance from Wizards of the Coast.
Oh, I've you mean the burritos that I continue to feast on to this day? Oh, my God.
Yes.
So there was this thing, for those who didn't see...
This is so crazy.
When we were doing the show notes, we're like, we have to talk about this. It's so ridiculous that we're going to talk about this, but we have to talk about it. So
we do.
We do. We just do. As you all know, or as many of you know, Luis loves burritos. Earlier that day, from the same burrito place, dude, the literal same burrito place that I'm
going to. Oh, my God.
It's the same place. It's the same place. So we just had these burritos at home. And so... He is like, he's in a really, really tight game. But then he like turns the corner and it looks like he's going to win. And when he's getting to, when Luis is getting to the end of this match, he just like whips out a burrito out of nowhere. Like he's just had it on his lap or something. And he just like unwraps the burrito and just starts eating it. And the camera's on him and chat loses it. It's a really fun, lighthearted moment where like, we were like, everybody was laser focused and the commentators were laser focused on this really close game. And then suddenly he's just like eating this burrito and it's a very funny moment.
I mean, so there's two things I want to say here. One is Luis, everyone kind of knows Luis for his puns and they are brilliant. Like the fact that he can make these puns and I know you see it and I've been there, they're not planned. Like you are in a conversation with LSV and he just starts dropping these puns out of nowhere. And you're like, how the hell did you, like, that was very clever. It's frustrating because they're all really bad, but you're like, that is very clever that you did
that.
Yes,
they're extreme like dad puns.
Yes. But it's almost like when you see someone who's like a rapper who can just do it off the top of their head, Luis is like that, which is pretty.
Yeah, you're
it's
like,
pretty,
how do you do it? Damn.
Yeah. I don't know how his mind's working. The thing though that I think people don't realize is Luis actually has some of the most, and this was a prime example, some of the best comedic timing I've ever seen in my life. Like actually just like completely will drop a joke at this moment where you're like, holy crap, that timing was unbelievable. And I think this was a good example of it.
Yeah. No, I agree that he just like picks really good spots and this was a very good example of it. So yeah.
The other thing is,
go ahead.
You know that Luis, when he's going to get goofy, he does have this weird like head bob.
Oh my God, he does. He has a tell where it's just that you know he's about to like say or do something really stupid. Yep. He's just like, yeah.
And I was watching this and I saw him like, wait, what's going
to happen? What's about to happen?
You just see his burrito come out.
It was really, really good. So that's what happened on the broadcast. Everybody got a good kick out of it and it was just fun and lighthearted. And just good. So then later in the day, like people are making jokes about Luis and the burritos. And at some point, Wizards tweeted something. And I think it was just a joke, kind of just a joke. They go, I think Luis said, like, I'm out of the tournament. I can't top 8. And so Wizards is like, well, if you manage to top 8 this time, the burritos are on us.
Yep.
And Luis goes, you know what? I'll take you up on that.
Yeah, I'll hold you to it.
Yeah, I'll hold you to it. And this is just exchanges that you can see between the Wizards like Magic Esports account and also Luis's Twitter. So a lot of people saw this exchange and they were like, oh, lol, that's going to be funny if it happens. Then Luis actually top 8s. And we're like, wow, incredible. And so we were here at home and I didn't even stream that day because I was like, I started getting so nervous when I thought he was still live in the tournament. And I was just waiting for the tournament to be done. I ended up just like not doing it. So while we're there and we're like waiting for results and stuff, like after he has definitely gotten there, we're like, let's go walk Julie, because we hadn't walked her yet. So Raptor, mm-hmm. Luis, and I go and take the dog out. And during the walk, we're like talking about, hey, what are we gonna do for dinner? Like, what's our plan for dinner? We were just like making the dinner plan. And we didn't actually order anything while we were on the walk, which was good. And as we come back around and show up at the front of my house, there's just like a stack of like food containers in front of the house. And we're just like, I'm like, what is this? And Luisa's like, oh my God, these are the burritos. Like, and this works because Wizards obviously has our address for a bunch of other reasons. So mm-hmm. we just showed up and there were like 5 burritos or something.
So many burritos, by the way.
What the hell? Burritos. Yeah.
And they were wet burritos too. These were just like rolled yeah. burritos. Like wet burritos.
Yeah. Yeah, they were like, they were, what's it called? The covered? It's
smothered. Smothered and covered? Smothered. I don't know.
That's yet. Smothered. Yeah. Smothered. That's what it is. So we got the burritos and obviously tweeted out that we got the burritos and had a really fun time about it. Well, some people on the internet were not happy that this happened. And some of the complaints that there were like Reddit threats about it saying like, that's cool that LSV got burritos, but like, why didn't the other top 8 players get burritos?
Oh my and God. It's. Yeah.
It was really.
This is why we can't have really nice things. This is why we can't have nice things.
That's like, exactly up. How I felt. It was just like, look, I understand this, like wanting to have things be fair. But if people have reasons to be mad about Wizards, which there's plenty of reasons people might have, like sending a burrito about this moment that happened in covers that was like really fun and people enjoyed, that cost like at most $50, is not one of the reasons to be complaining. My God.
I mean, I feel this is, I mean, you know, we both are on the marketing team, you know, work with the marketing team at Channel Fireball. This is good marketing. Mm-hmm. The whole exchange with the burrito and the esports account saying, if you top 8, we'll make it a burrito. I think Luis makes the top 8 and he responds to the announcement by saying, you know, at Wizards Esport, my DMs are open. You know, that's just good social media use. Everybody, it's good marketing. Following up on the burritos, good marketing. Like the weird thing here for me is in my brain, this wasn't just, maybe they shouldn't do it. Maybe they should do it. It was
not close.
Excellent yes. social media, excellent marketing. I loved it from start to finish.
Yeah, I felt the same way. And it was just frustrating for people to be like, for people not to be able to kind of see. Also, Wizards spend so much money working with influencers and doing paid campaigns and doing this other stuff. And this burrito exchange, like, was just worth so much more than a yeah. lot of other things where they could have spent their money. So it's just frustrating for people to be like so upset about that like, oh, but they got the burrito, but like, that's not cool. That part's really not cool. When it's just like, why? I mean, the fact that you're complaining about this means that Wizards is always going to be like, okay, it doesn't really matter what we do. Like, it could be the coolest thing in the world, but somebody's going to figure out how to hate it. And
I mean, it discourages future action like
that. Yeah, I agree. And like, these yeah. are things that made, like, this made the broadcast so memorable. And it was such a cool, and like, you know what? Like, full disclosure, I couldn't even eat the burritos because the burritos had beans. So I couldn't have them because I can't have that. It gives me acid reflux, as we were talking about earlier.
God, wow.
I know. Beans are the other thing that I had to forego. But so
you can't have pizza sauce either, right?
Yeah, it's like, those are like the big three things that I can't have. It's like marinara sauce, beans, and bacon. And like super fried stuff I also can't have. And I just kind of like cut those out of my diet and I have a much better life because of it. But it's annoying.
Can you eat hominy?
Yeah, that's actually okay with me. It's just like okay. the kind of like the refried beans, like the kind of like more Mexican beans really kind you. Of mess me up. You. Yeah.
I love pozole. And you'd mentioned brunch earlier, and that's like one of the best brunch
items in my life. It's rough because I love beans. I like yeah. really, really, truly love them, but I just can have very little or like almost not at all. anyway, that was then later known, came to be known as Burrito Gate, which just kept being referenced and made a joke for the duration of the weekend. But I was really happy that it happened, really unhappy that we had to have this discussion. It was very like, this is why we can't have nice things. Like, this is just going to make the people at Wizards not want to do stuff like that. And it was so fun for everybody who got to kind of see that exchange happen through the weekend.
I mean, I want to be fair to people who are critical of this because I'm always trying to like, okay, what is the other side thinking? I think that this is just symptomatic of a lot of frustration with organized play.
Yes, I agree.
And you know, it found this outlet, because when you have that kind of pressure and frustration, it's going to find an outlet somewhere, and this happened to be it. But it still ain't great, you know.
Yeah.
And it's unfortunate. We're talking about it now. It was a hilarious thing, you know, from the Luis and the Magic esports side. I don't think you do anything different, to be honest with you. Like I said, I think they just did everything right. Talking to Luis and Raptor, though, here's the real question. How were those burritos?
I think they were all right. I think they liked it. Yeah. I didn't try it at all, but I got such a kick out of the fact that this happened, because it was just, like when we just showed up back at the door and there was just a stack of food. I'm like, what?
Perfect.
And it was funny because I had gotten messaged by Wizards earlier asking if I was at the same address, and I didn't even think about it. Like, it didn't click. And I thought maybe they were overnighting stuff to the top 8 players for whatever reason. And I was like, oh, they must need the player's address, because Luis is maybe going to make the top 8. So I'm like, yeah, I'll confirm that I'm at this address.
Sure.
It didn't even register.
Well played, Wizards. Well played.
Yeah, it was good.
So that was one of the, in my opinion, one of the high points of the broadcast. There were some low points too, Gabby.
Yeah, there really were.
This was challenging, because I actually went to tune in at 9 and I was like, hey, what's going on? I said, oh, 30 minute delay. Okay, well, all right. Football is going to be on around 10, because like, you know, Sunday it's football. And I was like, okay, well, you know what? I'll watch the half hour before football goes live. And then I go back, I'm like, what's going on? And it's like, wait, a 3-hour delay. And I feel bad about this. I kind of tweeted out a snarky thing, like, how long does it take to order burritos, you know?
Oh, my God.
I deleted the tweet. I feel bad about it, because, I mean, look, we've run digital events. We still run digital events. We have one this weekend, the CFP Pro Showdown. Stuff happens. And so I didn't want to be part of that dog pile, but wow, this blew me away to pull the plug on the whole day. What were your thoughts here? I mean, Luis being a competitor in it, I mean, it had to be just surreal and strange.
It was a really weird experience. Ever since I started playing Magic around 2012, maybe.
Zoomer.
No, like, I think like millennial. We can give me millennial. Zoomer is Arena people. If you join Magic via Arena, you have to be a Zoomer. So I get the millennial tag, I think. But
okay.
Ever since I started watching Magic, I've never seen that happen. To my knowledge, it's never happened before. Like, a broadcast actually get canceled and just be like, okay, well, we're going to pre-record it and show it tomorrow. I worked in coverage for years. I've been watching coverage for years ever since I started playing Magic.
I don't think it's ever happened before.
And that's basically what happened. It was like, it was in half hour increments where I was like, it's going to be another half hour. It's going to be another half hour. And I was just like, at some point I was just like, Luis, in the beginning I told him like, I don't want spoilers. Like, I want to watch the games. I wanted to. And then it just kept happening so much that it was like, okay, whatever. Like, I just don't even know are you even going to play today? Like, what's going to happen? So in the end, it got pushed 3 hours to the point where they decided that they just couldn't have the broadcast anymore. Mm-hmm. But it was brutal, because this is an international tournament. There were people who were up like way past their bedtime. And if it was just a matter of trying to continue to fix it that day, it was going to be like 3 a.m. for some of those folks that were playing. So they went ahead and recorded the tournament, and they recorded the matches with the commentators, and they turned it into a VOD essentially that aired the next day at like 4 a.m. Pacific, something
five,
like that.
Five, I think it was 5, 5, 5 it launched 5 a.m. Pacific. Yeah.
Which also is like, like, who's up to watch that, at least in the U.S., because it was supposed to be during U.S. times. Obviously, like, international folks could watch it, but I was just so surprised about the whole thing.
So that's what happened. And I'm just curious. We can Monday morning quarterback this a little bit. Like, what if you're producing this show, what would you have done? I mean, I could throw some options out at you if you like.
Yeah. So I don't know what happened on their end that made it that they couldn't stream. This is what they said. Today's broadcast of the Mythic Invitational would not be moving forward as scheduled. We are experiencing issues and sending signal from our main show switch out to transmission that are preventing us from broadcasting the show live. The only way I can interpret this is, all their assets and all the way they could do the broadcast lived in like basically one server or something like that. And then for whatever reason, they could not access that. And then they couldn't move forward with the broadcast because there's, I mean, obviously their broadcast is a lot more complicated because they do have a lot of moving pieces and everyone's like kind of international. Absolutely. When they're doing it. But it just, it blew my mind that they couldn't like get it to work after a couple hours. Like, I have a really hard time understanding what possibly could have happened for that to be the end result.
So, but if that's happening, what do you do? Like, so, you know, option one could be maybe you run a stream that's way stripped down. None of the bells and whistles, like Magic Fest Online. Hey, you know, Riley, you Skype in. Marshall, you Skype in. We're going to put your images there. It's going to look janky, but we're going to run the games and it's going to be high level magic. And we're going to do it that way. It's not the polish or the production we want, but the show must go on. We're going to do it. Suit up. Let's go. That's like kind of like option one.
Yeah.
Option two maybe is like, okay, guys, take the day. Be back tomorrow, Monday morning. We're going to run this thing full tilt boogie. We're just time shifting everything we do Sunday, 9 a.m. Monday. Come back. Let's play magic. Let's cover magic. Let's do it. Okay. And that assumes that all the competitors have the day off and they can do it. I don't know.
And all everybody who works for it too, because like a lot of the commentators have other jobs.
Right.
Yeah.
So, I mean, let's just, assuming that's possible, that's an option. Right. And then, you know, then there's this kind of like maybe option. I actually had to work. And even working at Channel Fireball, like Mondays are extremely busy. Mondays and Tuesdays are my busiest. So I just didn't have an option to like watch this. It was not going to be possible for me.
Right.
So I don't know what it looked like, but maybe two other options are, okay, we're going to record it now as if it were live. And then we're just going to run a totally like live seeming production. Obviously chat's not going to be there. Start it Monday at some time and run it. And then maybe option two is, okay, we're going to record it all as usual. And then we're going to post-produce the heck out of it. It's going to be the slickest, most post-produced product ever.
To make it like really worth watching.
Really, like, we're going to cut the 9 hours down to like 3 or something like that. Like, just really the highlights. And we're going to make this thing so beautiful. People are going to love it. Starting at 5 a.m., that's a very tough time.
Yeah. I think from all the options you mentioned, I think the first one I would have looked at is The Show Must Go On, because I don't know. It kind of blew my mind when they canceled the broadcast, because in my mind, that just wasn't an option. Like,
yeah.
The option of let's not do the broadcast today and let's figure it out tomorrow just felt like I would do almost anything before that became the problem, because there were several thousands of people who were excited to watch this thing on Sunday who probably couldn't watch it on Monday. I kind of had it too, because it was at 5 a.m. Pacific. I wasn't going to get up at that time to watch it. And so I think the first thing I would have tried is like, even if we have to do a more bare bones version of this, like how could we do it? Or even record the matches and then maybe have the commentators go over it live without spoiling any results, so that maybe the players can go to bed, you know, you get the matches done, but then the commentator team and the rest of the world gets to see like the matches as they're going. Like time shifted style. I guess following that, I would have done what they did of like, hey, cancel it today, we'll do it tomorrow, we'll just get all the commentators to continue doing their work today. But I don't know, it's just, I felt really bad for everybody involved. I felt bad for Wizards because that is just a colossal failure. I felt bad for the commentators because they had extremely long days, because they had a call time, and then they were just like, you know, when you're on call time and you know you're about to go live, you're kind of in this like amped up state of like, I'm excited, I'm gonna do the thing, I'm gonna be on camera, I'm gonna commentate, and then it's like 3 hours go by and you're like, well, I guess what's I would like on? To commentate, but I don't know. Maybe I won't commentate today at all. And all the commentators had that experience. And same for the production staff. And the players. And the players got iced.
It sucks for everyone all around. I do want to shout out the commentators. I think Riley was up to like 4 or 5 working.
Damn.
And it's just like, you know, that's the kind of stuff we don't see. And there's a lot of focus on players. You and I, obviously, we know so many commentators. We're going to tilt in that direction. So, I think the team, and even with Wizards, like Wizards, the you know, I know they're in charge of all this, but with all of these things, whether it's CFB events or another company, they're paying a third party company to do this. This wasn't a failure on Wizards' part. They paid someone good money to run this show. So, you know, I think they got some flack for it. It's just like, there's only so much you can do. They're not in the business of doing this. They're in the business of marketing these events, creating these events, and then paying someone to run it for them. It's really not their fault. So, I mean, I'm really sympathetic for everybody involved. It was just really heartbreaking. Rough.
Also, that production company's probably not going to get hired again. My God, can you imagine?
Yeah, it was brutal.
The
call I got from Sasso was like, well, and the reason I can ask you this with all these options, he's like, what would we do? Like, here's a very good, live example.
If you were just in that spot, what do we do? Yeah. What would you have done in that spot?
100% show must go on.
Yeah. 100%. I seriously didn't consider that was even an option. Like, nowhere in my mind did it occur that let's just do it tomorrow. It's like, no, mm-hmm. The Mythic Invitational Top 8 is today. We're going to show something today.
Get the camera on Marshall or Riley and, you know, listen, mates, I'm going to level with you. We're having some technical difficulties, but we're going to keep going, you know, and just go. That's exactly what I would do. No question. I'm like, let's just be honest with the audience. Hey guys, it's not going to look pretty, but we got great magic here. And what's really important here is you get to enjoy the game and watch the game. And we're going to do everything we can to bring it to you. And boom, we're off to the races. 100% what I would
totally agree. No one of the things that Luis and I felt very strongly about, and one of the things we actually differed with the way Wizards wanted us to handle some stuff that happened during broadcasts is that whenever we did broadcasts with CFB, we're just very honest about when there were problems or things that happened. Like, mm-hmm. Hey, the internet is really bad at this site and we're having issues with a connection. We'll be back shortly. Or, hey, there's a judge call going on down there. We don't know exactly what's going on, but it's going to take a while and they're getting, it's getting escalated. Multiple judges are coming. So we'll give you a lowdown of what happens then. But in the meantime, we're going to go take a look at this other match. And we always felt that when we were just upfront with the people who were watching about the struggles or the difficulties during the broadcast, people were much more receptive to be like, oh, I understand. Like, I get that there was this problem or the internet was bad or the computer crashed or whatever. That's cool. Thanks for letting us know. Versus in a lot of other broadcasts that I worked at where our instruction was to just not say anything, just pretend that it didn't happen. And people would be like, do people not are we just acting like nothing happened? Like, it'd be like if they had run that broadcast and never acknowledged that there was anything wrong with it. And people were like, are we just going to pretend that the broadcast doesn't look like the way it did yesterday? Or I guess we are, sure. And I feel like just being sincere, being honest and upfront with people just gets such a better reaction in that spot.
Oh, it's so, I mean, you put yourself in the shoes of the audience. Obviously, we were the audience, but it's like, I don't know. Put your hand up if you ever had internet connection issues.
Yeah.
Everybody's hands up, right? Yeah. I mean, how many of you have been in a tournament where there's been a lengthy judge call that's held things up? I don't know. Everyone who's played
literally
a live match,
everyone who's watching. Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, you know, those are the things where we always want to empathize with each other. And as a company, one of the things that we strive for, I know, is trying to have that empathetic moment. But when you're honest with your audience, when you're honest with, you know, the people you're engaging, they can empathize with you because you're being honest with them. And that's important in situations like that. And I think that's what's missing when you try to hide the ball. It's like, whoa, what's going on here? You're not being honest with me. And now all I'm focused on is how something's not right. And you're not being honest with me about it.
I think it actually also triggers something in people where they're they feel like they're getting tricked or something, because they kind of are. That's kind of the exchange that's happening. So I think it also makes people focus more on the what are you hiding from me? Why are you hiding this from me? As opposed to the, oh, yeah, I get it. There's internet issues or there were production issues or whatever happened, because we don't actually know what happened over the weekend. Okay, but the show's going to go on and it's not going to look as it's not going to look the way we envisioned, but whatever. We're going to get to watch the top and it's going to be fun.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm with you. We should end on a high note though. There is something that kind of got introduced.
Yes.
Here, which
this was cool.
I thought this was unbelievable. And actually, you explain it, Gabby, because I didn't even know what was going on. I was like, "What is this? It is so awesome."
So basically, if you are not super familiar with Twitch loves to copy. It's called copy pasta. It's just copy pasting people's messages, usually memes. They don't necessarily make a lot of sense, but they're usually pretty funny. And people were trying to root for Gabriel Nassif, who goes by Gab, right? And there's this other meme of these like dancing crabs that just like dance to the song. So somebody made this. Yeah, exactly. So somebody made this copypasta that said like, like paste these crabs to help out Gab. And yeah. It was,
and it's like in between peppered, every word.
Yes, peppered yeah. Between every word, there was just like a crab emoji. And so it started out with people like, you know, like getting on that bandwagon and being like, oh, this is cool. And they started copy pasting it. And then the Wizards mods were deleting everything. And people were like, so lame. Like, we're out here trying to support Gab with the crabs and Wizards hates it. Like, this is why Magic's not never going to be an esport. And like, people were kind of like salty and mad about it. But people actually, like the commentators and excuse me, the moderators took it to heart when people were saying that. So they like approached Wizards and said, hey, should we be deleting these? Like, these are kind of cute. These are kind of funny. And they're like what Twitch works like. And Wizards decided to embrace the memes. And they're like, you know what? Yeah, let's do it. Just like let them do it. So then people went ham. It was like, post these gators to help the commentators. There was like,
post the poop for Shoop.
Poop for Shoop. Just really random stuff. But it was actually kind of cool because it reminded me so much more of when I watch esports for other games, like what their chats look like. Because like, for better or for worse, Twitch is like that. Like, people want to post gators to help the commentators. And it was sweet to see Wizards embrace it and like tweet about it and just let people know like, hey, these memes are welcome. Like, we're actually, we're in for it.
I saw one that was a pretty big stretch today. There is a boomer. I'm quite sure he's a boomer. Who, because he was eliminated from some Zendikar qualifying event by someone who was ineligible to play, got the qualification. It's Kyle Rose. Are you familiar with who Kyle Rose is?
I think so. Question mark? I'm not sure.
I believe he's a former U.S. national champion, and he won with a deck called White Lightning. I'm pretty sure that was Kyle Rose, which actually caused a rule change in Magic. The card he used was called Waylay, and it was like the white ball lightning. It was a 3-mana white, one white, two other, put 3/2/2 first striking knight tokens into play, sacrifice them at the beginning of your next end step. So you would cast it during your opponent's end step at the beginning of the next end step.
And you would get them through your turn.
Yep. It was awesome. So anyway, Kyle Rose won. And so then what it was, someone had shirts and it was paste these clothes for Kyle Rose. wow, we're really going deep here. So
we're scraping the bottom of the barrel.
It's awesome. I think it's amazing, and I thought it was one of the burrito stuff were hopefully the positive side of the burrito stuff, and all of these like crab for Gab, poop for Shoop, you know, gators for the commentators is the legacy of this event. That and just really some seriously great Magic play. So I was happy. If that's what we come away with moving down the road, I'm very, very happy, and I'd call it a success. So, all right, Gabby. Boy, there was a lot going on. I mean, I feel like we could have kept going for another hour here, but we are.
This has been a busy week.
It has. Definitely not a mailbag week, which is our slow week stand-in. But that is it for us this week. I am Mashi Scanlon, the guy on the left at Mashi Scanlon's, where you can find me on social media. She's Gabby Sparts. You can find her at Gabby Sparts, or if you want to hang out with her live and in living color, twitch.tv/Gabby Sparts. You can find the podcast at Magic FM Podcast on Twitter. If you're listening to the podcast, please hit that subscribe button. Also check out channelfireball.com or YouTube. We do a video. There's a video component to this show and we're hanging out, having a good time. So if you haven't checked that out, do check it out. We try to have a little fun. There's a lot of expressions, a lot of emotions.
Yeah.
We both emote pretty well and talk, gesticulate with our hands and stuff. So check that out. And of course, if you do want to sign up for CFP Pro Showdown this weekend, use that code MAGICFM or any purchase on channelfireball.com. Use the code MAGICFM. That supports Gabby and I and all the content we make and this podcast. So that does it for this week. Until next week, everyone, be wonderful to yourselves. Be wonderful to each other.
Bye-bye.